Blog Talk Radio.
Oh yeah.
Everybody, and welcome to another Tuesday night broadcast of Real Talk All the Time, 100% real, unpolished, unrehearsed, unapologetic, with your hosts, myself, H.J. Morgan. We got Rob Hall in the building. Sinead is not with us tonight, but we're going to chop it up anyway and get it in. We have an excellent show lined up tonight, man. This one is going to be a good one. So get your libation and whatever else you got going on there and sit down and on this nor'easter that we've had over here the last, 24 hours now here in the Northeast.
Yeah, no bell.
So crazy, go ahead and get by the fire if you have one and, get cozy with us.
No doubt.
I'm welcoming my main man here, Rob, back with us. He's been in and out. Due to work scheduling and stuff like that. So, Rob, glad to have you back, man. What's going on with you, brother? How's everything?
Hey, man, I can't call it, man. Just mad busy, but you know what I'm saying? I love a Tuesday night always, baby boy, you know, to get it in and chop it up. Real talk all the time. You know how we do.
Yep. Yes, sir. Absolutely. It's good to have you back, man. Good to hear your voice. And I do want to give a shout out to, definitely. Thank you. I want to give a shout out to Sine also. Yeah. Just real quick, the call in is 657-383-0612, 657-383-0612, and you press 1 to talk to us. I've been getting some messages after the shows of people trying to come in and speak, and they weren't able to do so, so I just wanted to put that out there again. Of course, the website is www.realtalkalltime.com. Now, the website right now is down. I'm working on fixing that issue. So bear with us. The website will be back up here in a day or so. So we'll have that back up there for you. You can catch us on Facebook and Twitter. All right. And the chat is open tonight. So if you want to type your messages or comments, you can do so there. And, of course, you can call in and press 1. So tonight, our main topic, we're going to have a friend of the show, our brother Gary Heyward, man, is coming back. Author of the book Corruption Officer. He's going to talk to us about some things here in regards to the justice system and things like that. A couple of projects that he's been working on that's been a part of here as of recently. We're going to talk about that. We're also going to talk about this tragic case of Kalief Browder, a teen that was wrongfully sent to Rikers Island at the age of 16, spent 3 years there without any trial or anything, no representation, and it's just a tragic story for those that don't know about that. So we're going to definitely talk about that tonight with Gary Heyward as well. So sit tight, folks. We'll get to that here in a few minutes. But Rob, being that we have you back, man, do you have any interesting entertainment news that you'd like to share with us before we move on tonight?
Two things. Want to shout out to the Sledge family, Sister Sledge.
Yes.
You know, back Joni Sledge had passed, you know, from natural causes. She was at the age of 60. And I tell you, for us that were younger that used to get down, you know, with our parents, we are family. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That was one of the anthems back in the days and stuff. So special shout out and rest in peace to Sister Joni Sledge and everything, man.
Yeah, man. Wow. And, yeah, salute to her.
Shout out to her. No doubt. You know what I'm saying? And then the next thing I want to talk about, you know, it's kind of funny because it kind of spins a little bit into politics as well as entertainment. Okay. Snoop Dogg had recently did a video. And in the video, I guess it's an individual that's dressed into a clown outfit, you know, to emulate the person that's in office. So there's a certain scene in the video that he takes shots at him. And, you know, actually, you know, with a toy gun and things of that particular nature. But people are in an uproar and saying that Snoop Dogg should be ashamed of themselves. Now, the thing I'm trying to understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, is there such thing as freedom of speech? And if so, is it for certain people or is just for, you know, or I mean, I'm trying to understand how does that freedom of speech work? What do you got, bro?
Yeah, well, yeah, there is such thing as freedom of speech. I mean, you know, let's look at the flaming of President Tangerine on Saturday Night Live and stuff like that. So, you know, you know, but yeah, definitely there's something as freedom of speech, or at least they used to be. I think that as we move on, we may see that pulled back away from us a little bit if we let it. I think that might start to be a thing of the past under the current regime if we continue to let things happen the way they're going. But I tell you what we should be ashamed of. If we're not, we should be ashamed that we got a fool like this in the president's office. I mean, if you want to be ashamed of something, be ashamed about that. You know, just my thoughts. I mean, you know,
absolutely.
I mean, really. But yeah.
Absolutely. You know, it's just funny, man, because you have other individuals out here. It was a situation, and I didn't realize you had posted this story, but I posted it after you on Facebook, you know, about the KKK down in Georgia.
Yeah.
I mean, they just openly putting things out, recruiting and all kinds of stuff.
Yes.
These individuals were known for killing people.
Right.
Let's not get that shit twisted. And now they're taking off of a terrorist watch list, and I'm like, wow, you know, it's truly amazing. And you got other people, you know, that are really talking very reckless now.
Oh yeah.
And just for those that are talking reckless, I need you to understand something. The shit that happened back then is not going to happen today because there's a lot of people that will see you and call you on your shit. Let's not get that switched.
Right. And I think that's the nice version. That's the laid back version. So read between the lines on that one, folks, honestly. But here's the thing, Rob. We spoke about this in depth over the last couple of years, and we said that if this guy should get in because of the way he ran his campaign, that you would have groups like the KKK, because he spoke to their hearts, apparently, come out and start acting up again. And, I mean, you know, recently we've had this lynching in Seattle, okay? Of course, you had the Dylan Roof shooting of that church and stuff like that. And now you have these guys want to march around now freely again like they used to back in the days in their sheets. Now, you have that situation in Georgia. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I believe coming up here, I want to say, is it coming in May or something like that? They're trying to have this big march in South Carolina or North Carolina. Anybody from the Carolinas that listens to the show, hit us up or go ahead and get us in. Hit me with the inbox with that information, because I know they're actually trying to march somewhere in South Carolina, North Carolina. Have a big in fact, because I know it was mentioned on Minister Louis Farrakhan's Facebook page that this is what they're trying to do. So we're going to be seeing things like this happen again. Now, here's the thing: for those of you that don't believe it, you have the KKK up here in the north, you know. You have them in New York, in New Jersey. You have KKK. At one time, there was a Clavern, which is a KKK clubhouse, somewhere in Astoria, Queens, for those that don't know.
Wow.
And you also, of course, in Long Island, all in Long Island you do. So this is, you're going to start seeing these people parading around again, because this was the green light that they got from President Tangerine. This was the green. Uh-huh. This was the, out of everything that he said, they got that message from what he said. So this is what you have now, man. And then you had the Indian man got shot, and what was it, in Kansas or something like that, or somewhere, I think Midwest or the South. And a guy walked up to him in his driveway and said, you know, you don't need to be here in this country, and shot the man. And the man was a Sikh or something like that. You know, so this is what you got, man.
Yeah,
this is what you got going on,
Rob. It's just sad, man. It's crazy, man. Yeah. It is crazy, bro. Yeah, man, that's pretty much it, man, from the entertainment side of the house, man. You got anything else, you know, politic-wise?
Well, you know, not a whole hell of a lot. You know, we continue to do this dance with these executive orders. Now Trump has made an executive order the first executive order that he had that was, you know, banning people from coming into the country. That one got blocked by the court. So then he made another one, changed a few words, basically the same thing, and had that one come out. You know, so we're playing games and things like that. Here's the interesting thing: this case with the tapping of his Trump Tower, which is complete and utter bullshit.
Come on, man.
I watched Kellyanne Conway the other day. We asked certain questions in regards to this. This chick is insane. Either she's insane or crazy like a fox, because she don't never answer the question. She started talking about microwaves and shit like that. Now we're talking about are we talking about microwave ovens? I mean, what's going on with this lady?
Saying?
Lady, we're talking about phone taps. And she went off into some other shit. You understand what I'm saying? Let's keep it real, Rob. Let's keep it real.
Yeah, no doubt.
If I was in a meeting at my job, and somebody said, okay, so, you know, Mr. Morgan, we're going to do about XYZ, and I was talking about the endangerment of seals and sea life, they'd be like, what? You know, they'd be like,
exactly.
Mr. Morgan, we're talking about XYZ right now. Well, you know this bitch goes off, man, into left fucking field, dude.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
All the time.
You know, she's like that character in Life, that movie Life. She's like Can't Get Right. She just can't talk correctly.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just some other shit
absolutely.
She be talking about.
Absolutely.
What the fuck you talking about?
She be pulling some shit out of her ass. Yeah.
You know?
You
know?
And
the crazy thing is,
do you blame her? Yeah, do you blame her, or do you blame the motherfuckers that keep entertaining the shit?
Yeah, this is ridiculous. Yeah, alternative facts,
no
bro. This is alternative facts.
Yeah.
You know,
you're absolutely right, brother.
Alternative
absolutely
facts
right.
run wild out this motherfucker. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you know, this is what we got going on.
Real talk,
you
man.
Know?
Yeah, it's crazy, man. It's insane.
So,
man.
It's a mockery, and we are a mockery. There's a picture that went viral of a some type of sculpture or float that they had in Germany. I think I mentioned this last week. And it's the picture of of Donald Trump bending over the Statue of Liberty, you know. You know what that statement basically means, you know, that F your liberty and F your rights.
Absolutely.
You understand? So, you know, it is what it is. You know, it's just it's very sad
real talk,
that it's come to this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you know?
Here we are.
But my thing is this, though, Rob. One thing I am, in all this darkness that I'm very thankful for, is that I see exactly who my enemy is. You understand? I don't know. Are you getting this, too? Are you seeing exactly who's who now that all this has come to light?
Man.
Give me, like, some of your experience here, just real quick. Like, what are you seeing right now?
Oh, I'll tell you, man. Ever since, you know, as you say, the Tangerine got elected, a lot of people, man, around me have shown certain things that I wasn't necessarily privy to. I mean, there were certain hidden clues, but now certain things are on Front Street. And people are really starting to show themselves, and people are starting to feel a little comfortable doing certain things. But they know how to catch themselves around me, if that makes sense.
Oh,
you
it makes perfect sense.
Yeah. So, but it's an awakening, if you will. And I tell you, man, I welcome it. I welcome it. I'd rather know who exactly who's who, and especially with circumstances like this. And I mean, especially let's just even go to like social media. Oh yeah, man. Oh yeah, like people, you know, especially Facebook. We use that. There's a lot of people that are just really, really putting it out there on how they really feel about certain things, man. Mm-hmm. And it's just beautiful to know that. So I sit back in the cut, bro, and play observant.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think, and here he is. So, and it was right on time.
All
right. We're gonna go ahead and jump right on into this. I'm gonna bring him out, my man. I'm trying to let's see what's happening here.
Yeah.
We had okay, my man. My man, G, you are live, sir. How you doing?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm all right, sir. How you doing?
Hey, I'm hanging in there, man. I'm trying to make sense of the shenanigans.
No doubt. Yeah, good to have you on the show again, brother.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Good to have you on the show.
Good to be here, man. Thanks for having me, man. Yeah,
absolutely.
No doubt,
so, for those that don't know and don't read the headers on the show, we have my man Gary Heyward here. He's an author, friend of mine, friend of the show. He wrote the critically acclaimed book, Corruption Officer. I'm not going to even take his shine. I'm going to go ahead. For those that don't know, G, go ahead and let the people know who you are, a little bit of background on yourself and things of that nature.
Well, my name is Gary Heyward. I was born and raised in Harlem, Polo Grounds Project. I'm a decorated war veteran, Marine, and I was a correction officer for 10 years on Rikers Island, and then I went to jail myself for all the stuff that you hear and see in the paper that correction officers do. So I went to jail for that, and upon my return on my road to redemption, I penned a book about my life as a correction officer, Rikers Island correction officer, and signed a major book deal. And as we speak, Will Smith just optioned the rights to do the movie to the book.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Wow,
man,
that's fantastic,
bro.
Brother. That's fantastic. You need to be a strong day on jail.
Strong J.
Wow. That's wonderful, man. I mean, you know, it's funny how, you know, you turn something so horrible into a positive, man. So I got to give you your props for that. And you didn't let it break you, you know, and you didn't let it ruin your life. And I think that's a testament to the strength that, you know, we all have if we dig down for it, man. So I got to tip my hat to you again on that, brother.
Thank you, sir.
And it's good to have you back on the show, brother. Good to have you back. I do want to go into a couple for those that haven't read the book or what have you. Just go into a little bit about what the book is about and give them a brief synopsis on the book, and we're gonna get into some things here about the legal system here right after that, because I have some. Of course, we know the story of Kalief Browder and things of that nature. So we're going to go into that as well. But just give them, you know, what the book is about, you know, a synopsis, if you will.
Well, briefly, the book is about my life of 10 years. Everything that I went through as a correction officer, my experience, the things I witnessed. The book is nonfiction, and it in details a lot of stuff that goes on in jail that's not privy to the media. And,
right.
You know, it's nonfiction. It's a lot of true-to-life situations that made it to the paper, and some don't, but it answers and it enlightens anyone who wants to know the life of a correction officer, the life of an inmate. If you're married to a correction officer, if you want to be a correction officer, the book enlightens any question that you may want to know about being an officer, and, you know, especially an officer that's growing up, because a lot of correction officers come from the inner city neighborhoods. You're 9 times out of 10, if a correction officer is born and raised here in New York and they get that job on Rikers Island, they're going to see somebody, a couple of people they know in that prison system. And the book kind of explains how to cope with what you have to do for your livelihood, for your job, or what you have to do for people you care for that has landed into that system. So it enlightens a lot. It makes a lot of points. It enhances. And if corrections wasn't so biased toward me and my actions, they could learn from the book, and they have learned, not that they're going to give me credit for it, but they have changed some of their policies because of my book to try to, you know, stop correction officers from doing the things that I did, you know, on the island. So that's briefly what the book is about.
Wow. Wow. That is interesting, brother. That is interesting. Quick, I'm going to go ahead and bring the resident degenerate in. This is another brother that joins us on the panel sometime. My man.
Oh, yeah.
CB, are you on?
What's good? I'm at the job, man. Snowed in like a motherfucker. Ain't nobody moving, but it's all good. I'm here with my brothers on Real Talk. You're going to get it cracking and lacking.
What's up? Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I think I can't get a booty call, so I might as well get some Real Talk.
All right. Well, there you go. That's the next
there
best thing. Next
there
best thing.
Have.
So
yeah.
We're chopping up with
Absolutely.
Our brother. We're chopping up with our brother Gary, and you know, about his book. You know, Gary's been on the show a couple of times already, so I just wanted to give a little background on that. I do have a question, and it's in the realm, but slightly off. Slightly off topic, just slightly. In the recent days, we found out that Mike Brown most likely did not rob that store in Ferguson, and at the end of the day was shot for nothing. As somebody that has been in law enforcement before, what's your thoughts on that? This is something that many of us in the street had a feeling of anyway. But now these new videos have surfused. What's your thoughts on that, man? Like when you see people say, "Oh, damn," you know, what do you say to that?
This is my thought. First of all, thank God for letting them put cameras on these phones.
That's right.
You know, because
Real
from
talk.
One law enforcement person, it's been so lopsided. Like, people think when you swear in and you take that oath on that shield that your word is God, meaning, okay, let me rewind. I had a situation where I went to go to court to fight a traffic ticket. The cop
right.
showed up. He went to the judge and said, he ran a red light. I pulled him over. I gave him the ticket. After he told the judge that, the judge looked right at me and said, what proof do you have that you didn't run that red light? And I asked
wow.
the judge, what proof did he have that I did? Just his word. So what I mean by that, now you take the Brown situation. If that video didn't show us what we thought the last couple of days, law enforcement can paint the picture or try to paint the picture to the media that this guy was a bad dude. So without footage, I mean, think about how many cases, how many people, how many times somebody said that cop planted that drugs on me or no, I didn't do what that officer said and was unheard. The judge didn't want to hear it. And they did a lot of time just because a law enforcement person said you did that. So
classic case, Reuben Hurricane Carter. Look at Hurricane Carter.
Yeah.
Remember him?
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
So. But it's a day late and a dollar short when, after the fact, after our brothers are murdered, that these videos come out, they're innocent,
right.
That didn't happen. So, I mean, we got to try to get in front of it before things happen, but that's a hard fight. So my thoughts on it is that, I mean, what can we do right now to try to stop stuff like this from continuing to happen? You know,
right.
we get video
right.
footage after the fact that the person got killed for nothing.
Right.
You know,
right.
it's crazy to me.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Rob, your thoughts on that? We just got this video came out, and they're hemming and hawing on it, but they're tap dancing, but they're basically saying that this man never stole nothing from this store. So
I tell you, man. Yeah, bro.
Mm-hmm. No. What's your thoughts on that?
Oh, okay. Yeah, the sad reality of it is this, Ben. Like anything else, you find out things after the fact, and especially in law enforcement, it's supposed to be, you know, the totality of circumstances, and you're supposed to have probable cause and all these other things and stuff like that. Now, you do have some people that are actually doing their jobs, and then you have these other individuals, because of their authority, they get out of pocket with the shit. And like my man said, Gary said, you know, thank God for these cameras, because it goes both ways. I've seen it to where, you know, people had said that they got raped by police officers. They, you know, the whole point of the evidence, and I'm not saying that doesn't happen, but there's cases where it doesn't happen, and some people will say the same thing. Now, from the law enforcement side of the house, you have a lot of corrupted people, especially, you know, when you talk about some of these cities. The biggest one that you always hear is either New York or like L.A. You know, those are the, like, top two that people talk about. Not saying that other departments may or may not be corrupted. But at the end of the day, it's like, damn, I mean, when you look at a demographic of people that are found guilty for, I mean, just because of somebody else's word, and then the same circumstances happens to another person, and, you know, it's a slap on the wrist, or they got a good attorney that'll be able to talk things down. I mean, the shit is just sideways, and it's sad, you know. And right. Then now, okay, right. the young man lost his life. What can you tell his parents? What can you do for the family? You know, what, right. Say my bad? There's right. No monetary value that you could put on this young man's life that pled his innocence, and everybody right. Knew this shit. And then now, all of a sudden, after years, here comes some, you know, some videos to say, oh, by the way, damn, he may not have done that shit. It's sad, man.
Right. Absolutely. And there was ripple effects from that case all across the country, throughout that yes. region of the country, especially. You had another brother that was killed mysteriously that was an activist in that case as well, that got killed, I think, just last year. And he was shot and burned to death in his car. There was a many things that happened, horrible things that happened after this case. So it touched mm-hmm. a lot of people directly and indirectly, you know, it all based off a lie. You know, it makes me think of that story of the Rosewood town that was burned to the ground and people were brutalized. You know, so I mean, but so we look at that, and this is where I get pissed off at people. You look at a story like that, Rosewood. And then you come to fast forward to 2017, and you say, okay, so what's the difference? This is still happening.
Yeah,
you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So don't tell me that, you know, oh, I can't talk about what happened a long time ago. Fuck you. This is still happening. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, still
this
relevant
is still
today,
happening.
Man.
All right? So another thing that this going forward here, back to Rikers mm-hmm. Island and things like that, and we're going to get into Kalief Browder case. Brother, you said that the thing about being guilty. Now, a lot of times, you're guilty if you're broke, meaning that if you can't afford to get the hell out of jail, you might as well be guilty. You might as well be guilty because your ass is going to be there until it's time for your trial. And of course, in the case of this young man, Kalief Browder, that could be many years. You know,
but
it's
that's
so
that's
tragic.
A system. That's a system across the board, John. You got to understand now, man. America is designed like that. If you fucking broke, you fuck. That's the same thing with the medical industry. If you broke, you're gonna fucking die. If you broke and black, you're gonna be locked up and ain't no telling when you come. My man, if OJ had been broke and did what he and that shit went down, OJ would still be in jail now behind that bullshit.
Right.
You and I both know that. We all know that. We all know that here. We can truthfully say that if you're broken black in America, you stand no fucking chance.
When you talk about Kalief Browder, I go like, okay, it's messed up what happened on Rikers Island with the correction officers and anything. But you have to look at the judge, the DA, I mean, the defendant, and the prosecutor, them three right there.
how is it this young man didn't get a court date?
Right.
How you let it go 3 years, you know, without nobody saying, yo, this guy has been sitting here for 6 months, a year and a half, and nobody's seen him. Nobody. He was never charged with anything.
Right.
Because they tied him up in so much bureaucratic red tape and judicial red tape that he basically seeped through the cracks. That's what basically happened.
Right. Right. Well,
here's the thing. It was also put out that, you know, like, I'm sorry, 85% of people that had got arrested up in the Bronx around that time basically had to plead out to get out of, you know, going or staying in Rikers. And I mean,
shit they didn't do.
How y'all were saying, you know, earlier. Yeah, shit that they didn't do. And this is the thing, too, and we talked about this, too, and shout out to my man Max, you know, Parthis for talking about this. The money that they generated by keeping them kids in there, that's what that shit boiled down to. The more, the more seats that you fill, the more money they generated, and that's what it was. So you tie them up into litigation and then force them to say some shit that they didn't do. Why? Because kids is getting beat down in there or they fed up. So they got brainwashed into, you know, confessing to some shit that they didn't do. So now, you know, you're paroled, but you got a record now. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Right. And here's another thing. Now, saying that, and about the money thing, the money connection with these children or anybody in jail for that matter, you have to look at our current situation as a country and really realize how dangerous the situation that we're in is. You have these privatized prisons in Montana, places like that are empty. And these towns that have these prisons are waiting for people to show up in these prisons so that the town can thrive off of the money that this prison is going to generate. Do you not see a recipe for disaster to happen? As soon as Donald Trump was elected president, these private prisons cheered with joy because they know what's going to happen next. They know what's coming next. So you're going to have 10 Rikers Islands, if you will, all across the country because of greed and things like that. So this is what we're looking at right now. This is very dangerous times.
The whole thing is too, Ja. The whole thing is too, not to chime in. You gotta understand something. Soon as a black man is going through Central Booking, they already setting him up for failure. Because what's the first thing they do? Oh, well, you can get your public defender. Public defender don't give a fuck about your interest.
Right.
Right.
They don't give a fuck about your interest. They just trying to make a name for themselves. So they're going to go in the top-notch lawyers and the prosecutor that he already noticed. They were like, okay, the public defender, he's just going to do the bare minimum, and we're going to hook, line, and sinker this shit. And that's going to be it. Done. Case closed. Right. On to the next one. On to the next Negro. That's how they look at that shit.
Right. Well, let's look at this real quick, and then I'm going to give it to Gary, because I want to get into this to the documentary that you were a part of, by the way. For those that don't know, Gary Heyward was a part of this documentary about the last few years of this man's life, Kalief Browder. It was very, very sad. I watched part one and two, and I'm gonna tell you something, man. It was very, honestly, it was actually hard to even put together this broadcast about this topic because I already knew the background of the story. I know how the story ends, and it's just a heartbreaking story. So this is easy broadcast to do. Seeing this, man, you have so many questions. Why? Well, what could have been done differently? You know what I'm saying? For those of you who have not seen it, please see it. It's definitely a must-see. And once you see this and you see other documentaries like 13th, You have to sit down and ask yourself some real ass questions about the judicial system in America. What the fuck is this bullshit? You understand what I'm saying? So those two you must see. You got to see the Kalief Browder story and you got to see the 13th. And then sit down and say what the hell is going on after that. Gary, so you were part of this project, this documentary. You know, I mean, what from your point, from your point of view, what do you know about the Kalief Browder case, and how things went down with that, and just, you know, Rikers Island's the way they handled the situation. I mean, the man was jumped repeated times by officers and prisoners. Just go into that, if you will. Just your involvement with the project, and also, you know, the things that go down with in situations like this. You probably see hundreds of Kalief Browders, and it's unfortunate. But I'm gonna give the floor to you, sir.
First, I was when they first approached me to be a part of the docuseries. You know, they did their research. They saw that I was an analyst on CNN several times, Fox 5, Pix 11, you know,
right.
Channel 7, you know, front page of the Daily News, New York Times. So when they approached me on it, they wanted my expertise opinion about the corruption that goes
right.
on Rikers Island that could have led to this young man's demise.
Right.
So, now, the story that we have is he went to prison, never got charged with anything. They held him solitary confinement for over 800 and something days.
Yeah.
And then he came home. He met Jay-Z, was on a Rosie O'Donnell show. And the day after he was on the Rosie O'Donnell show, he committed suicide. So
Damn.
I'm sitting here, I'm looking at the footage. First of all, I want to say somebody got paid heavenly
right.
to get the footage of this young man. Because
right.
every footage they have in there, I know how Rikers Island rolls. Anything that's going to make
yeah.
the officer look crazy, they're not going to let the media get it if they can help it. Put it that way.
Right. Right.
So now, when I look at this footage, of this young man getting jumped repeatedly, being separated, and some way, you see right there, if you look at the footage closely, the officer is standing there when the other couple of inmates go back to the door, kicks it open, and jumps the guy
again.
They're standing right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, jumping
so
again.
Now,
yeah.
Yeah.
Unreal.
So now I'm putting myself, as I'm watching it, I'm putting myself in their shoes. Like, first of all, okay, things happen. The lopsidedness about the Department of Correction is, okay, I know I'm jumping from subject to subject, but a lot of people are saying close Rikers Island down. Close it down.
Right.
I'm saying revamp the system, because if you take a dirty officer from Rikers Island and put him somewhere else in Nova Scotia in another facility, he's still going to be a dirty officer.
Right.
The practices are still going to go on. So when I watch these officers let these inmates go back and fight again, and you hear all the quote unquote people talking about, oh, these officers have something called the program where they allow inmates to jump the other inmates, or you allow them to fight. Now, the lopsidedness about being a correction officer is you have two correction officers watching from 60 to 100 inmates. You may have 30,
yeah, which is insane.
30 on the A side, 30 on the B side. Sometimes 50 on the A side, 50 on the B side. Is not humanly possible for two correction officers to stop that amount of people if they want to jump somebody. Well, now, you look at the film, you see Kalief Browder forever fighting. Every time you look around, fighting. Now, you're saying, why is that? It's a lot of reasons. He has to defend himself. You know, if you throw a person in the jungle, they're going to have to become a predator or a prey.
Right.
You know, so
real talk.
I really particularly in the second segment when they tried to paint him as a blood, as a bad individual when they were interviewing him. You know, my opinion is, like one young man said, you're looking at a 16-year-old young man, boy, 16.
Right.
What did you know at 16?
Right.
And
yeah,
being
talk.
Thrown into that environment like that, the footage you have is of the correction officers and the Department of Corrections wrongdoing, But nobody knows the mental state. Like you said, I've seen dozens and dozens upon hundreds of people get out like Kalief Browder did, get released without being charged. And because they're just so happy to be out of jail, they didn't press charges, they didn't follow up, they just wanted to be out of jail. So when this happened to this young man, I mean, it's unfortunate he committed suicide. I just want to throw a question out there to you. Would we be having this conversation if he didn't commit suicide? You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Would it be would it be that serious? You know, would people be paying that much attention?
Yeah, Gary, let me say this, man. I'm gonna jump in there right quick. You know, you said something that was paramount, because let's just take the suicide part. Now, actually learning, you know, more about that, he actually learned and tried to commit suicide, if I'm not mistaken, 5 or 6 times in there. So he actually learned how to commit suicide in there. The brother was locked down in a cage, and I think he was in solitary confinement the majority of the time that he was in there. So
he basically
became somewhat, you know, stir crazy, if you will. You know, you're talking about a 16-year-old. So once again, the mental capacity, and then you're surrounded by a whole bunch of older men, you know, some people his age, and things of that particular nature. And then, like how you said earlier, Gary, as far as, you know, you basically become the prey or you become the hunter, you know, in an environment like that. So one of the big things, you know, one of the big things that people keep, you know, calling these places, which it's just not a true statement. You know, when these people go to prisons and jails, they're supposed to be rehabilitated. These motherfuckers actually learn how to be better killers or be better con artists, if you will. For the most part, I'm not saying some people don't get rehabilitated, but I think that that term that they utilize for that is not necessarily true, because I don't see what measures are they taking to rehabilitate an individual, and especially when, like Gary, you said, all right, how the hell do you expect to actually do an effective job if it's 2 correction officers watching about 60 motherfuckers? There's no way.
Right.
They set you up for failure. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Absolutely.
I have 2 comments I'd like to direct to G. One is this. Now, the last jumping that you know, when half the damn block attacked him. All right. Because he, you know, I mean, I don't blame him. He decided to retaliate because this guy spit in his face, and he, you know, he was like, you know what, fuck this shit. So, you know, he rocked off on the dude, and then everybody attacked him. One of the people said that there shouldn't have been that many people in that hallway to begin with. My first question is that correct? And why would, in your mind, in your opinion, why did you have all that many people in that hallway, like all these prisoners out of their cells or whatever the case may be in a small area like that?
Okay. You know what? It's crazy, because I discuss this very same thing in my book. What it is his procedure. If you and I are the 2 COs watching 100 inmates, when we take the inmates out to go to chow to get something to eat, we have to pat frisk them when they leave the housing area. We have to pat frisk them when they arrive to the mess hall before they go in, to see if they acquired any weapons along the way to the mess hall. After they eat, we have to pat down these 100 inmates again when they come out the mess hall to see if they haven't acquired any weapons while they were in the mess hall. And then we have to pat them down again when they come back to get back into the housing area. Now, that means that 4 times you pat down 400 inmates, right?
Wow.
You're not, there's not a correction officer alive that's going to do that. And that's in the rule book that you're supposed to do. So what happens is, during the feeding, that's when all the housing areas are eating. That's the worst time for people to get stabbed, fights break out, or stuff like you've seen on the video. So in order to try to maintain order, They try to rush it along, and they have more too many inmates in the hallway, in the corridor, at the same time trying to get things done quickly and not by the book. Any correction officer mm-hmm. know that you cannot run a jail effectively by doing things by the book. So they cut corners. So that's probably why you see so many inmates in the hallway at the same time.
No doubt.
Now, like
no doubt.
I said, you only have two officers with 100 inmates. So I'm going to tell you, one of the duties as a correction officer is, if a bunch of inmates get to fighting, it is not, I repeat, it's not my job to break the fight up.
Wow.
It's not my job.
Mm-hmm.
My job is to stand back, give direct orders for them to stop fighting, and observe who's fighting who. So the outcome of anything, at least until help arrives, so that then we can probably break up the fight. But me and my partner are supposed to observe the guy in the green shirt stab the guy in the red shirt. The guy with the blue sneakers hit the guy with the white hat or whatever. You're supposed to be there
to
take in detail. That's it. And account, because sometimes inmates stage fights, so you could come over there, try to break it up just to get you in the mix. So they say purposely, do not jump in there to break up an inmate fight. You ought to observe what's going on, so when it is broken up, you know exactly who started it, who did whatever. So that's probably why all of those was in the corridor at the same time, which was very unsafe and and it's not practices. They're not supposed to do that.
So let me ask you this, I got to ask this. So how long from the time you call on the radio that, hey, we got a situation and then jumped off in this block, how long between the call and time the people get there to help you guys out, average?
I'm going to be honest with you. It varies. It varies on who's on standby for them calls. It varies on the distance that you are from what's called the staging area. You could be at a close housing area where they could get to you in five minutes. Or you could be halfway across the jail, and you have, I hate to say it, you have a bunch of correctional officers who are not in shape trying to get to you. It's going to take some time before they get down there to you.
Right.
So a lot can go on. You know, come on, 3 minutes in a fight is a long time.
I was going to say If you're in a street fight, you know, 60 seconds is a long time. It's even longer if you're getting your ass whipped. If you're on the wrong end of the ass, that's like, oh my God, when is this going to end? You know what I'm saying? So,
let me caveat off of this too. Gary, you said some shit that was tied now. Also, you have the scared motherfucker that doesn't want to come and do his job. Because I run across that shit too. I'm in the police aspect of it. I'm a trainer now. But there were situations to where you have a fight in progress, and I'm talking about veteran motherfuckers that are sitting in the car and have the door locked and won't get out because they scared to go out there and get an ass whooping or whoop somebody's ass. So you have those individuals too that are there to get a paycheck and do the bare minimum too. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And I think it's even worse for the correction officer. I think it's worse for the correction officer because, again, y'all only got a handful of people that's supposed to respond to, you know, a shitload of people, which is insane.
Wow.
Damn.
That's crazy. And I got to ask this, make this statement and a question, if you will. Now, you mentioned in that segment how they tried to paint him as this blood. I think this is at the deposition. They were trying to paint him as a form of blood or whatever like that. But here's the interesting thing, and I have to commend Kalief Browder on this. Now, check this out. Here it is, a young kid in jail. He can't go home because they don't have the money to get him home. Now, one of the ladies that was interviewing him even said, well, rather than go through all of that, being jumped and attacked, why not just go ahead and claim your set and run with your crew? Now, here's the answer that he gave. He said, no, I'm not going to do that. He said, because they might do something. They're going to do something that I don't agree with. So clearly this kid was not a thug criminal. Clearly.
Mm-hmm.
Just that statement alone. He was not a predatory thug criminal. He said, I'm going to be in here neutral. First of all, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm innocent. Okay? And I'm not going to go ahead and claim a gang so I can run around and feel safe and do shit to other people that and harm other people. That's basically what the guy said. So how, a young kid, 16 years old, who could have had the backing of 30 to 40 people, declined that. He believed in his innocence. Yeah. He said, I'm here to prove I'm innocent. And if it takes one, two, 3 years, then damn it, that's what I'm going to do. How this kid had balls, man. I'm going to tell you something right now.
No doubt.
How many adults know would do that shit?
Let me say this.
Yeah.
Whenever the city is in trouble, what do? They don't focus on what they did. If a person is in, I'm just going to say in plain English, they know they was in trouble with what they did with this young man. So try to sway the odds in their favor,
right?
They try to paint a picture of why he was in jail, why we kept him in solitary. He was a bad guy. He was this. He was a blood. He was this. What does that have to do with him not supposed to be in there from the get-go? Tackle that first. Before you say it, try to paint the picture, he's a blunt, he's a bad guy, and claim your set, they was waiting for him to say the wrong thing to try to justify what they did. But instead of getting to the matter, fact of the matter, he shouldn't have been there from the get-go.
Right.
You know,
right.
So what does me being a blunt, what does me having fights, what does that have to do with y'all screwed up paperwork or slipped through the cracks or however of me having to go through 3 years of torture?
Right.
I tell you, man, it was dodge and bait. You have to get people to believe in one thing while you're doing some other shit over here. You know, like prime example, and this is a little off topic, but it's along the same lines. Same thing with this politics shit. You know, they say one thing to throw you completely off of what's going on over here. So they'll throw some random shit out there, and especially the media. The media takes shit and hype it up. Like, let's just take it in this case. If people didn't know anything about this young kid, they would have ran with that shit and believed that he was this type of gangster and thug and all of this other shit and blah, 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 and ran with it without knowing what the full story was. Now, my question is, all right, the accuser, where's this motherfucker at? How is this motherfucker feeling? You know what I'm saying?
Listen, I actually want to I want to run this by you, G. Gary, I want to run this by you because this is what I'm thinking. This is what I'm thinking, and I want to know what your thoughts are on this. They say that he stole some backpack, right? Allegedly, this backpack had a camera, $700, and an iPad or something like that inside of this backpack. The accuser's story changed several times. Several times.
Mm-hmm.
That right there set off a red flag. Now, here's my theory. I think that whoever backpack it was lost it, was doing some other type of shenanigans, and it got taken somewhere else, or they lost it, or whatever they was doing, maybe in their own ignorance, it came up missing. And because it's easy to go someplace and blame a poor black person for something, you know what? I know what I could do. I could blame a nigga. I'm being real. Blame a nigga. How effective? And you know what? I'm saying it in a dark joke, but how easy is it to blame a nigga? Seriously, is it to blame a nigga? I'm a black person. Go ahead, G. What's your thoughts on that?
I think that it was a quota type thing. Number one, the accuser changed the story 100 times. The cops could have just how many times the cops jump out on kids, pat them down, let them go.
Right.
Jump out, pat him down, let him go.
It's happened to me.
They could have did the same thing. Go ahead.
No, I said it's happened to me before.
Yeah. They could have did the same thing with this young man and the other guy that they jumped out on once the person's story changed. So it was like, okay, we got to fill a quota. Let's make the collar anyway. So they tells him, it's no big deal. We're going to bring you down to the station. We're probably going to let you go. Just like it says in the docu-series, he never went home from there. Now, once you have him in custody, the court-appointed lawyer. Then you set the bail, which you think is low, but where his family can't afford the $900. Then when they finally get the $900, you, years before that, when he was even younger, he got 5 years probation for joyriding a little kid.
In a bread truck.
Joyriding on a bread truck. So now that mm-hmm. forced him to have to be held on, you know, be held and not given no bail. Now, we're not talking about some big drug dealer that got mad bodies on that's capable of escaping, jumping bail and flying to another country. We're talking about a kid whose family is struggling for $900 to get mm-hmm. him out of jail on a shaky case. And as far as I heard, the accuser disappeared throughout
wow.
his 3 years of being there.
Mm.
So now you don't have no witness coming to accuse him.
Mm-hmm.
You have
mm-hmm.
no reason of holding him. You have no reason to deny the bail to let him out. I mean, it's on so many levels, the ball was dropped on this this young man's life.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's crazy from the police officer, from the arresting officer, to the people interviewing him. You see the interview, they got the footage of the interview of the night he got arrested.
Right.
You know, and then from his defendant to the judge, and then the system, the paperwork from there. When y'all going to call him to court? They said every time it was time for him to go to court, people was on vacation, they adjourned
yeah.
it. On vacation, there are other cases, they adjourned it.
Hmm.
3 years later, my man? Come on, son.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's crazy.
Yeah.
3 years.
That is crazy.
3 years.
That is crazy.
And
but
then,
at the end of the day,
you know,
go ahead, Rob, I'm sorry.
Mm. No, it's all good. But the thing that got me was they were talking about, you know, time served. And I'm like, how the fuck is it time served for a motherfucker that wasn't convicted? That's the
Dig
shit
it.
I don't understand. You know
right.
what I'm saying? I mean, how
right.
and then, okay, he gets out, and it's like, you know, I mean, what kind of, like, compensation do you get? You know what I'm saying? And his case was 3 years. Let's just say a motherfucker that been in there for, like, 10, 12, 20 years.
Right.
How
right.
do you compensate a person like that? How do you give them their life back? There's no money or no nominal or whatever amount of money that you can give to a person that lost so much. And especially when you talk about a spot like Rikers, motherfuckers get it in over there. You know what I'm saying? Or what
mm-hmm.
is it like hard in prisons and things of that particular nature, man? Oh, man,
right.
it's just sad, man. Right.
It is. It's gut-wrenching. That's why it's so difficult to do this. It's so gut-wrenching. But here's the thing, and I got to point this out too, G. So, all right, he was the passenger. He wasn't the driver of this bread truck. He was riding around this bread truck. That's how he got the 5 years probation. So that's
mm-hmm.
a nonviolent crime, if you will. Okay, I'm throwing air quotes. That's nonviolent. Okay, this backpack that was taken, they never said that the person who the victim was assaulted or beaten up, and it was a strong arm. You know what I'm saying? Anything like that, physically assaulted with this backpack
yeah.
being taken. So again, another nonviolent crime, if you will. Again, air quotes.
Mm-hmm.
How many times in the last couple of months, G, have you seen a white rapist rape somebody on tape, and they got the tape, and the judge throw the shit out? I don't understand this. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
How many times have we all heard in the last year, Brock Turner, several others, raping small children? They just had a case recently out west where these white football players sodomized a black mentally disabled boy with a hanger. They just got off.
Mm-hmm.
So these
yeah.
are crimes that somebody's been hurt. Go ahead.
I got one better than that. If you go to my page, Corruption Officer page, right now on Facebook, there's a video up of a correction officer raping a 16-year-old girl in the jail cell. Now, I didn't believe
wow.
it until I saw it.
Wow. Wow.
And I'm like, why isn't this blown up all over the place? Because I looked at it and discussed, like, he's really on camera having sex with this girl in the jail cell. He slams her down. He punches her. And,
oh, my goodness.
And I don't hear it on the news. I don't hear no uproar about it or anything. I mean, people are sharing it like crazy. Now,
right.
The double standard of what goes on to our youth, to black people, is crazy. Let me tell you something. As a correction officer, an inmate once asked me, I have been there for about 5 or 6 years, and he said, Heyward, where are all the white inmates?
Right.
And I had to sit back and think that at that time, I had never, I'm not saying they never went on there, but from my experience, I had never seen a white inmate come through that jail.
Wow.
And I'm like, how does the system do that? How do you, I mean, I know white folks out there committing the same crimes we committing.
Right.
How do they not go to Rikers Island?
Right.
Yeah.
You know? So that was crazy in itself.
Yeah, that's amazing right there. I mean, like you said, they commit crimes too. Where are they being sent? You know, I guess it boggles the mind, but it takes me back a little bit, just briefly, the history of Rikers Island itself. I mean, the place was named after a gentleman who had something to do with the judicial system in New York many, many, many years ago. I think 1800s, something like that. And apparently this guy and his cronies used to go around kidnapping escaped slaves or people that weren't slaves at all and selling them back into slavery, like on some 12 years of slave shit. So this Rikers Island was named after somebody that used to do this kind of shit. You understand what I'm saying? So, and in actuality, also, some of your first inmates onto Rikers Island were young children who were kidnapped, basically, just the way, you know, like I said, 12 years a slave, just waylaid somewhere, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Knocked out, and next thing you know, you wake up and you're in Rikers Island type shit. So, I'm saying that to say this, the shit that we're seeing today is not too different from how the inception of the place to begin with. They started out doing that shit, and they still doing it now. Again, we beef about shit that happened 100 years ago because it's still happening now. And I don't give a fuck what nobody say. I'm going to continue to talk about it because it's still relevant. You understand what I'm saying? It boggles the mind, G. It boggles the mind, Gary. You know what I'm saying? It boggles the mind. Now, so... I mean, so were you able to meet Kalief Browder's mother at all at any time that you worked on the documentary or no? Okay.
No, actually, when they interviewed me for about 3 hours for this docuseries, I don't know. I'm going to be honest with you. I tell people to watch it because I want them to know this young man's story. I don't know how much throughout the docuseries that I'm in. No, they told me I'm on a couple of episodes and everything, but I'm watching it all the way through. It's a six-part series. But when they was interviewing me, at that time, too, the mother was ill. You know, she was having heart problems. So she wasn't available. She wasn't available, you know.
Okay.
So, no, I didn't get a chance to meet her at all. And, this, to me, is eerie because when you watch this docuseries, these are not actors. This is what happened. This is reenactment. No, they're talking to him, and they're talking to his mother.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's crazy, eerie, you know, surreal that, you know, even though we all know the outcome, but the fact that they're talking on this docuseries, he's explaining to the world. He's telling you, I didn't feel the same when I came home.
Right.
Because of what happened to me. He's crying out during the docuseries.
Right.
You know, and just sitting there, just still, even right now, you know, it's hard to look at, you know, and I consider myself, I ain't no gangster, but, you know, I'm 100% man, you know.
Right.
But you're still sitting there looking at this
it's
story.
Hard. It's hard to watch, man. It's hard to watch,
No doubt.
I'm going to tell you, like, it's hard to watch. I had to take a couple of deep breaths a few times while watching it, man. It's just, it's surreal. It's like, how the fuck can this happen? And this, you know, we live in what we call a modern times. How does something like this happen? You know, it just, again, if you watch the other documentaries, 13th, and then you watch this, boy, you're left asking a whole lot of goddamn questions.
In.
I tell you that
shit right now.
You know?
It ties in.
It's like, wow, man. So basically, you're talking it twice.
Experience.
Yeah. You're talking it twice. You're talking it once because you're black and twice, the second time because you're broke. So it's like, wow, you got two strikes. You know? It's really unfortunate. It's unfortunate. Clay Birch, you've been quiet, brother. Any questions there for our brother Gary here while he's on, man?
I mean, you got to understand something, man. Jim Crow is not dead. It's not.
This is 2.0.
And you know what kills me? People be like, oh, there's equality and justice. No, there's not. Tell that to the black man. There's no fucking equality and justice. There's never going to be equality and justice. Like I said, in order for you to have equality and justice, you have to be willing to stand up and make a sacrifice, and that means a total revolution. People don't get that. Because when is enough going to be enough? You can't keep doing these fucking power marches and all these peaceful. No. That's just not going to get it anymore. Yeah. And people have to stay vigilant with their fucking phones. I mean, you have to stay vigilant with your camera phones. If you see some unlawful shit going on with a cop and a black man, you got to get on there and record that shit. And people are like, give me your phone. No, I'm not giving you shit. Fuck you. Eat a dick. What you going to do? You going to shoot me too? Then shoot me, motherfucker.
Yeah.
You might kill me.
It's coming to that.
But I'm
going to
be a fucking martyr.
It's coming to that, man. It's really getting that ugly, man. And it's unfortunate. We live in very dangerous times, man. Like you said, earlier in the segment, if we didn't have these cell phones recording some of this stuff, man, oh man.
Even that. Think about all the people that have been prosecuted, that have been unlawful, that has been unjustly prosecuted because there were no cell phones.
Right.
Think about all them people.
Right. Hundreds, thousands,
maybe.
Right.
Yeah. It's even hard sometimes when you got it right there on film that they're wrong.
Right.
It's still even hard to get them convicted, you know?
Right. You're right.
Exactly.
You're right.
That they did something wrong.
Right. Yeah. And then they try to convince you. Then, they say, well, you're not really watching what you think you're watching. What is this, the fucking magic?
Yeah,
you know? What the fuck am I watching?
You know what I'm saying? You didn't catch all the footage and shit. You know, but
you know
I guess
saying?
to put a positive spin on this, Gary. Again, man, I gotta give you mad love and a big shout out for the simple fact, bro.
Yeah, I give you big respect, homie.
Yeah, you took a positive into a negative. So now, when you tell your story, and then when you have a plethora of people, if you will, that are following you and they seeing what you're doing, and it shows that, a black man can rise from the ashes and become that phoenix and become that stronghold, you know, and show something different than what we're seeing that society deems is African-Americans. You know what I'm saying? And everything.
Understood.
You're being successful, man. And so I truly appreciate what you bring to the table, bro. And again, you keep doing your thing, man. And I wish you well on the projects and things that you got coming, you know, to the forefront, because this is something that we need. And especially now, you know, you talking about Will Smith picking up the movie rights, man, and that's going to reach another platform of people. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
It's going to put you even further where you need to be, man. So,
brother, I give you a lot of respect. I give you a lot of respect for the simple fact you brave enough to actually do this shit, because I'm going to tell you something. A lot of people would have just been like, fucking, I'm going to mind my business and earn my paycheck and go about my business and turn a blind eye. But however, you did the opposite, and you got my whole heartfelt respect.
Yeah,
I appreciate
it. It takes a big and brave man to do what you did.
I appreciate that. I appreciate the love and the support. I mean, throughout my journey, it's going to be jail is such a vast subject. So, you know, even if you take away the movies and the books and all that stuff still need to be talked about.
You know, it's like I did an interview with MTV. I did an interview with MTV about this Kalief Browder, and they asked me, like, the difference in, you know, why do they think Kalief killed herself? Now, I said, it's a big difference. Now, we all men, and we all did dirt in our past, and we all know right from wrong. So this is what I said. In my case, I knew I was wrong. I knew I was husband in the jail. I knew I was doing a whole bunch of stuff I wasn't supposed to do. So when I went to jail, I made my bed, and I laid in it. So now,
no doubt,
like you said before, you take a person who did nothing wrong.
Yeah.
Who didn't do, that's a hard thing to deal with, that I went through all this hell and I didn't do anything wrong. Versus a person who did something wrong, like, okay, I know I'm going to do this time because of what I did. So if it brings, if my book, the movies or discussions, or, and I'll come on this show 150 million times if need be to reach who it needs to be reached to get the message out there. You know, that all this stuff is crazy. It's crazy and it's lopsided. And we have to open our eyes to a lot of, you know, stuff that's going on. So if I could reach one person, like my main message for my whole book and these discussions is, brother, sister, whoever, don't go to jail. That's as corny as it may sound, that's my main message.
Let me ask you something right quick though. What would you say to those cats that glorify jail as like a badge of honor? What would you say to those individuals,
man?
Listen, I'm gonna be honest with you. Dude, we got all these gangsters that some of us used to look up to, some of us know was thorough dudes, they put in work and everything. If those guys could take that back and be broke and free, they'll do that in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to be that gangster. Yo, you remember Ty? He was real. Yeah, he doing 50 to life.
Right.
Well,
because I don't care.
Like I said, as corny as it may sound, real people, real grown adults that value life know that jail is not the place to be, and it shouldn't be glorified on a lot of levels.
What did it for me? I didn't mean to cut you off. What did it for me was when I was young. I remember I was 13 years old, man, and we went to the Scared Straight program up in Rahway. And I remember, man, fucking prisoner was like, yeah, man, you know, we do the cute little light skinned, bright eyed motherfuckers like you, man. We've been over and fuck him in the ass. Yo, I never forget that shit. And from that day on, I said, I would never, ever, ever. I don't give a fuck, nigga. I won't even steal a motherfucking devil dog out of fucking bodega.
I hear you.
No doubt.
Real talk.
Because that shit was not watered down. Because you remember back then, that Scared Straight shit was not watered down like it is now. That shit is watered down now. But back then, that shit was, them niggas was like, yeah, nigga, you be watching my drawers, motherfucker. I'm going to sell your motherfucking ass for a pack of cigarettes. I was like, oh, okay, I'm good. I don't think I'm going to prison no time soon. I'm good.
That's right. I just want to say this real quick, because I know you don't have too much time left with us tonight, but I just want to say this. So, brother, are we going to see the next book, man, Copstitute, out soon, or what's the status of that?
Well, Copstitute is done, but it's kind of like a business move. Like, they don't want to release it into Corruption Officer. The movie was complete. Roughly in about 2 weeks, about 2 to 3 weeks, I'll be flying to California to discuss with some people about a Netflix series for my third book, which is called House Gang.
Wow.
So I'm working, but, you know, these people, it takes time. It's a process, you know. They got a lot of stuff on their plates, but you know, as busy as somebody like Will is. So, but I just hope that when the movie does come out, it brings light to a lot of situations, to a lot of things that happen to a lot of people. You know, I'm working, and I'll let you know that when Constitute come out, and plus I'm doing an audio book for Corruption Officer, which is going to be even crazier for you to listen to. So, I got a great go, but I appreciate all the love and support. I hope you have back.
Bro.
And I just want to say one last thing.
Go, brother.
The Kalief Browder segment comes on again tomorrow, 9 o'clock. Sometimes on Spike TV. Sometimes they run it back-to-back on BET.
Okay.
But every Wednesday was on 9 or 10 o'clock. You can catch a segment of the Kalief Browder docuseries. Once again, thank you for having me, family, but I got to run, all right?
Yes,
no
thank
doubt.
You very
no
much,
doubt.
Thank you, Gary.
No love, man.
All right, thank you so much.
Y'all take care.
Peace,
y'all take care.
All right, peace
all
out,
you
brother.
Too.
Wow, that's a friend of the show.
Man, actually, it's serious.
Gary, he was author of the book, Corruption Officer. You heard what's going down with him. Good things are happening for him, and I big up to him. He's got Will Smith looking at making that book into a movie. What's up. And, you know, again, he took a negative thing and turned it into a positive and has a message for the youth. One thing I just want to go back to since we're talking about Kalief Browder is for those of you that have watched the documentary, here's a young man who was brought up in a foster home. He was fortunate enough to have all his blood siblings with him. His mother was a drug abuser, and the children were taken away, and they were given to his family, who took them in, him and his brothers, like they were theirs, and they raised them,
right.
You know, and they were doing the best they could. But I know I saw what a possible turning point, and again, he was not a hardened criminal. You know, at the very worst, he was mischievous. And he was looking for acceptance and love in his life. He found out, I think, at 13 that he was adopted. Now, I never went through that, but I'm quite sure that can be a very harrowing and trying experience in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
So
no
here
doubt.
You have a child who finds out at 13 that he was adopted. I can't imagine what was going through his mind, but it was shortly after that that he started hanging around kids who weren't necessarily doing the right thing. You understand? So, and these kids also didn't have fathers in their lives or parents in their lives. So he found a way to relate to these other kids, and that's how he fell into, you know, with these other groups. But still in all, he was not a hardened criminal. He joyrided in a bread truck, you know, okay. You know, like I said, they're kids of other, you know, they're white kids who would do much worse than that at 16 and never do a day in jail. So, you know, we got to get off that bullshit about, oh, well, he might have done this, he might have done that. I could give a fuck. When the justice system is inclusive of everybody, then we can start talking about shit like that. Until then, I don't give a fuck. I'll be honest with you. It's just really, it's crazy. Rob,
up,
I mean, you know.
How you doing?
And,
all right.
You know, it's just crazy. You understand? It's 2017, and shit is still so lopsided. When we talk about the justice system, still so lopsided.
Yeah.
You know,
justice system is designed to make us fail. You know that.
Right. Right. But if you're broke, you can forget about it. If you're broke,
yeah,
you
don't got no money
about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't got no money because that's a perfect example, man. Let's talk about the whole corruption thing. All right. Take the kid that had the affluenza, some new fucking term, because basically privileged. So this motherfucker gets off, the kid down in Texas that ran to Mexico, you know what I'm saying? So he gets off, Ma Dukes takes this motherfucker down to Mexico to run and hide and shit, and then he gets caught out there, you know, once again. And this was, actually, this is the third time that he got caught up, but the second time he got caught up, that's when that whole affluenza shit came about, and I mean, he was a repeat offender. The kid was driving drunk. The second go around,
running people over, bro.
Yeah, running people over and shit. And for the justice system to say that, yo, basically, you know, he's too privileged and shit. And
we don't
want to
ruin your life.
You know, we'll give him a pass. Man, get the fuck out of here with that shit, man.
Yeah, we don't want to ruin your poor privileged life. We don't want to ruin your lily life. So we don't want to send you to jail. But we'll take somebody
like
that ain't did nothing,
uh-huh.
And we'll send you to jail for the rest of your life. But you may get killed in jail or whatever. And then we find out
that
you were actually innocent.
Shit.
We'll say, oops, our bad. And that's basically what you got.
Yeah, our bad. Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? That's what you got.
It's just sad, man. It's sad shit. Sad shit.
It is. And like I said, I'm going to tell you, it was hard to watch those two episodes. And he says it's six and all. I don't know if I'm make six.
Yeah.
That's like
right
Dylan
now.
Roof. That's like Dylan Roof. Look at Dylan Roof. Dude, shout out the black church, man. The black people in church. You think that motherfucker?
Yeah.
He's not gonna get death. They're gonna get that motherfucking criminal insanity.
Right.
He's gonna get insanity. He's gonna get that shit. And he's gonna walk.
Right. Yeah. Perfect. You're right though. I'm glad you brought that up, CB. Dylan Roof has not been jumped as many times as Kalief Browder was jumped, and he didn't kill nobody.
No.
Can you imagine that? Think about that for a second, Rob.
Yeah.
Think about that second. CB, think about that shit. Dylan Roof, he got his ass kicked one good time. He got his ass kicked one time. The one dude put it on him. But as a whole, he has not been jumped as many times as Kalief Browder has been jumped in jail.
Well, here's
the thing. Kalief Browder has been jumped multiple times.
Yeah, but this is what you guys got to also consider, too. All right. South Carolina, New York City, right? So let's just look at the two different locations. For one, they're probably doing the job a little bit better down there in South Carolina to where, like, when you got somebody in protective custody, that's what that shit is. You protect this motherfucker in your custody. Now, they may be a couple of slip-ups here and there and shit like that. Now, take what Gary was saying earlier. You take Rikers Island. You got two motherfuckers that's supposed to watch 100. You honestly think that they'll be able to do the job efficiently, efficiently, or be able to watch everything. There's no fucking way in the world. You know what I'm saying? And then once again,
they know that, but these
other prisons have a system set in place to where they'll be able to watch and take care of certain shit. So when you look at some of these facilities and think, like, if you ever watched the show Lock Up, right, and the shit is just kind of incredible. You got all these different prisons and different types of, institutions, as they call them, throughout the world, not just here in the States, throughout the world. Like, I seen some shit over in Russia, man. Do you realize, man, in, like, a room that maybe, say, like, 10 by 20 feet, you got 20, 30 motherfuckers up in there. You know what I'm saying? And I mean, it's just insane how this shit works. And it's inhumane on how these cats are living. Now, don't get it twisted. It's not that I give a shit about prisoners. Some of them cats are innocent. Those are the ones that I really have, understanding for. And then you got some people that actually belong in there. You know what I'm saying? But the shit is not even across the board. It's not fair all the way across the board. We know
And until the system is actually at this point torn down completely and restructured, rebuilt, whatever, it's always going to be this way. You understand? The system just doesn't work. It doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
It does not work. Period. And we have to look at it for what it is. And you need to vote people. I don't know if you can vote somebody in or whatever, but whatever the case may be, you need to go ahead and get people that are going to be serious about doing the right thing by the people. And until that happens,
the only way to do that is you have to get that whole old regime out of there. That's your problem. That whole old guard is in there. That whole old regime is in there.
Right.
You got to start with them.
They gotta go.
Yeah, everybody. Yeah. You have to start from the top and work your way down.
You gotta start with those judges that been in fucking office for like 30 fucking 40 years. You gotta get rid of them.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But that's the thing. Right. I mean, unless they die out, they don't necessarily have to leave. Same thing with take a sheriff. Do you realize you take a sheriff, a cat that just came in, and let's just say all of us work for this particular department, right? So now here comes the new sheriff. And we've been working for the last sheriff for about 10, 15, 20 years. So this cat comes in and says, you know what? Fuck all of y'all. I'm going to bring my own people in. And they could do shit like that. That's how much power that these guys got. So it's the same thing with, these lawmakers, judges, and all of that. And especially the politicians, man. You know, the politicians have more power than you can imagine and shit. And they go into these places and lobby about this, that, and the third. And people, you know, sit back and act like they don't know what the fuck is going on, but yet and still you vote these motherfuckers in office and shit to make these laws. I don't get it.
You ain't lying.
You know what I'm saying?
But
so,
see, it's corruption.
So
it's corruption at the root.
Yeah, yeah. And all right, being from New York, I mean, you've seen things in growing up in, you know, especially up in the Bronx.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, what have you seen, like, from a kid up to now that has changed or hasn't changed?
Man, the only thing I've seen is change, man, as far as crime. Crime in New York has dropped a little bit, considering back in when we was growing up in the 70s and 80s, that shit was like a free-for-all. It was like Murderville up in this motherfucker. It was like you go on the train at 8 o'clock at night, you putting your own life in your hands. Shit's changed. But, you know, at the same time, it's like I have never seen so many cops killing fucking black people or like fucking open market. I haven't seen no shit like that in years. I haven't seen shit like that ever.
Yeah, yeah.
I have never seen this much of blatant misuse of police brutality. I mean, I've seen it growing up, but it wasn't that bad. You know, motherfucker, you know, a cop snatch up a motherfucker, knot him up, put him in a squad car. You don't know what happened. But now it's just out in the open.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about actually, like, in some cases, and I hate to use this verbiage, but they execute motherfuckers, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
and
that's what they basically doing.
You know, and I tell you, even like now, man, you know, I'm looking at different circumstances to where the justification of some of these individuals out here, you know, that's actually killing people, there is no justification, man. You got people that are unarmed. You got people that, you know, are abiding and, you know, they actually, you know, listening to task directions and stuff, man, and you know, unfortunately, you know, people are losing their lives, man, and I just, it's beyond sad. And then now with this Tangerine in office, and all these other people that are out here doing reckless shit, it's going to get a whole lot worse before it gets a whole lot better. Real talk.
Right. Well, here's the thing. I'm glad you mentioned that. So, okay, so it's not safe to do something bad and be in trouble with the law. It's not safe to comply with the law. It's not safe to be in accordance with the law. It's not safe to be stuck on the side of the road and ask for help from the law. What is it safe to do? If you're black in America dealing with law enforcement, what is it safe for you to do? You could be shot dead because your car broke down on the side of the road. You understand what I'm saying?
It's bad when you see black families talking about, oh, well, I'm going to tell my kids how to dress white in order to avoid being harassed by law. Let me tell you, when that gets to that point, that's when you got to say, you know what, enough is enough. Fuck y'all. You shoot us, we shoot y'all back. Hey, it is what it is, because somebody's going
to
die. I'd rather die standing up than be on my motherfucking, you know what I'm saying? I'd rather die on my feet than be on my knees.
It's getting bad. It's getting bad, and I just, you have to say to yourself, man, what's the answer? I mean, I know what the answer is, but, you know, when is everybody else going to figure this out, you know? It's just really getting bad. But like I said, I could be shot dead because I'm stuck on the side of the road and need assistance. Really?
I mean, just,
wow. Really? You know what I'm saying?
Let me ask you guys this, man, and this is going to be kind of profound. What if you took every black African-American person or somebody of African-American descent, and I don't care what race, whatever, but if you took all of them and put them outside of this country, how full would the prisons be? How much would the United States as a whole be worth? What do you guys think?
Huh.
Wow.
You know what? CB, I'll let you rock on that first.
I mean, say that again, brother. Just so I need to process this shit.
All right,
go ahead.
Here's the big thing: if you took African Americans, in any other race that is, you know, that has a descent around African Americans, right? You take them out of the country. And I'm talking about everyone. You know, like, we're over, let's just say we went to Mars. Shits and giggles, right? Every black person, anybody that has any type of, you know, African American descent in them, out of the country as a whole. Now, I'm talking about prisons, everything. So now they're out of prisons and all of that stuff. What would be the shape of the United States as a whole?
The economy would collapse. The economy would collapse. The economy would collapse. Law enforcement would collapse. Because, once again, man, this is how they're making their money. People don't realize. People be like, oh, blacks, minorities. No, motherfucker, we're not. We're minorities in the media's eyes, but in actuality, we're a majority. As far as consumer power, we're consumer power to be reckoned with. And as far as criminal-wise, unfortunately, we, next to the Hispanics, take up a lot of the fucking prison space.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that is done by design. Most of that's done by design.
Which is done by design, just like Habib said. So, like I said, if every African American or African American descent was to leave the United States, this country would crumble.
Yeah, it would. And I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna caveat on that. It would, and here's why. I think it's safe to say that the system that we live under is a system of white supremacy. I've tried to deny it to myself many, many years, but it's come back. The realization has come back to me in a haunting way. So I can't no longer deny that anymore to myself. I'd be lying to myself if I said otherwise. So saying that, that system works on the ability to make or another group of people suffer in some kind of way, whether it be monetarily, which is economically, whether it be through quote unquote justice, whether it be through education, you know, all across the board. So now if you take that group out of the picture, then white supremacy can't stand. It'll implode because now they're going to start treating each other a certain kind of way.
Yes,
you understand
what
I'm saying? Because you got, in order for it to stand, you got to have a lower class. You got to have somebody who's going to be that class we fuck with.
Yep,
now, once you take that out of that, now who do we fuck with? I guess we fuck with each other.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? You know, that's how that works. Just a little quick tidbit on this. Because I've studied this, and I just want to share this. For those that don't know, slavery here in America didn't just start as a black thing. You had, you know, the indentured servant program, which you had whites and blacks picking cotton and doing all types, you know, tobacco and all that types of stuff on these plantations. And they were getting, the white servants were getting their asses whipped just as much as the black servants were. And all that shit, right? So what happened was they tried to form your earliest unions, and they wanted workers' rights. Mm-hmm. That's how workers' rights started, actually. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And they began to rebel against these people who were sick in the head and were abusing them on these farms and plantations. And so little by little, they said to the white ones, hey, look, we ain't going to fuck with y'all like that no more, but here's what you guys can do. You guys can watch these other guys because you guys are just a little bit better than them.
Yeah,
and you're better than them because you know what? Hey, we have white skin. So because of that white skin, I'm gonna treat you a little bit better than I treat you. You know, you're still shit because you're poor white trash.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna treat you a little bit better than I treat these darkies over
better.
Here. And this happened, and it began to grow and grow and grow and grow until you had trans American slave trade. Okay.
Yeah.
And so
exactly.
That's how it really happened. Okay, so you know, once you take us out, Rob, it goes back to that. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because now you're not going to have a positive group, or a group that you can identify with a blinking of an eye to say that these cats are the cats we want to fuck with. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You can't identify them
and
too relevant anymore. you know?
And a lot of people didn't realize, man, China tried to capitalize on American prison trade, because a lot of people don't know, and this is a fact, a lot of people don't know, the Chinese president came to Bush years ago, Bush Jr., and told Bush, yo, we can take 80% of your prison population and store them in supermaxes here in China. Now, you know what they were going to use them for? Labor.
Right.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. They're cheap labor.
They were going to use them in labor, and Bush was like, nah, because he knew if they would have took 80, because China can hold 80% of the prison population with no problem. They have plenty of land.
Damn, boy, that shit is crazy.
Right.
They was like, okay, we can bring them over in ships. Because they told Bush, yeah, we could bring them over in cargo ships, just like a slave ship, once again. You see how the whole cycle repeats itself?
But this is what they do to their own people, too. So they'll do it to you. Here's the thing about that. They'll do it to you because they do it to themselves. Look what happens to Chinese people when they come to the sex trade, how they bring those girls over here to this country in those cargo containers.
In cargo ships.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
And see, not only was they going to use, and see, the Chinese are slick. People don't realize, man. Chinese, man, they into organ harvesting. So they'd have got a lot of black people over there into their country prisoners. Ain't no telling how many organs they would have harvested illegally.
Right. Right. Mm-hmm.
Everybody, we just all watch Get Out. We all just watch Get Out. That basically was an eye opener.
Right.
That was basically an eye opener. You know, it was a good movie, but it's actually because you look at the whole premise of, okay, if you got millions upon millions of African-American and Latino fucking inmates in a country where you motherfuckers basically ain't got no rights, I mean, anything could be done. Anything could be slave labor, organ harvesting, the whole gamut.
Everything.
That's why they wanted
everything across the board. Yep, everything across the board.
Yeah.
And plus, you're talking about...
Look at the fuckery, man.
Mm-hmm. I mean, looking from this perspective, too, how much stuff does China own in the United States anyway?
They own practically everything.
Real estate. Real estate.
Because we owe them trillions of dollars. We owe them trillions of dollars. That's why they own our shit. If they were to say, okay, you know what, we kind of need our money back that you borrowed from us, we'd be fucked.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I always joke around and I say, what if China says fuck you, pay me, like they, you know, like in Goodfellas.
Yeah,
exactly. You know.
I'm gonna tell you something very interesting. When I was working for this other company, I used to drive buses up to the Amish country. I would see nothing but busloads of Chinese people, man, going out to the Amish country looking at their land. And it's not like they're looking at their land as tourists. They were looking at their shit like, oh, okay, we can actually take this shit.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because you gotta understand something. A country as vast as China, their water is no good. Their air is horrible, because it's factories. You got 70% over there is factories. So when all your water and everything and natural resources is fucked up, what do you do next? You go to the next country that can provide that shit for you. That's bad when you have to have cans of air flown in from Canada. You selling cans of fucking air because your air's so fucking bad. The air quality's so bad.
Wow.
Yeah, that shit is crazy.
Yeah.
That shit is crazy.
Yeah.
So like I said, for them to take prisoners is nothing. For them to take 80% of the prison population in America, because they'd be like, oh, well, that's free labor. That's fucking free and cheap labor right there.
Yeah. Real talk, man. That shit is crazy, though.
Absolutely. Wow. I tell you, man, very interesting stuff. But another thing that would happen, too, Rob, if you take, let's say, us out of the equation, and let's say you take even indigenous people out of the equation, let's look at what they're trying to do right now with all these oil pipelines and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah.
They would implode because they would begin to chop down forests. They would overdevelop stuff. It would get to the point where this place would be uninhabitable because, you know, your eyes are so big that you got to have everything and everything. The mindset is that anything we put our hands on is ours. So, and I could do what I want with it. So what would happen is you would build so much and you would poison yourself. You couldn't drink the water. You couldn't breathe the air. So they would kill themselves.
This is where the
population thinning is about to start taking place. So you remember that shit I just posted on Facebook, and you posted shit on Facebook about that Hunger Games shit in Russia they having?
Oh, yes. Yes, that's right. In Russia.
Yeah, yeah. Damn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now this shit is, a lot of people don't realize reality TV actually started the premise for this shit.
Right.
Because a lot of people don't know the first reality show was The Real World. And that shit got millions of viewers. Now you put it on a whole new level. Motherfuckers actually getting killed out in the shit. Because, see, this shit is going to start in Russia. It'll start. You got to start somewhere. It'll start in Russia.
Right.
Then every other country will start picking this shit up. And before you know it, because, see, realistically, the world is over fucking populated. Natural resources is getting used up by the fucking tons every day. So what would be a better alternative than to thin the fucking population out than to have some shit like that?
Well, let me ask you this, though. Let me ask you this, Clay. Who is mostly using these resources to the point where they're you don't have any more? You understand?
Man, I'm gonna tell you something.
And you know the funny thing is,
it's not being used by us. What it is being sold. That shit is being sold to the highest bidder. They basically take the resources here and sell the shit to the highest bidder. And then what it is the little bit of scrap. That's the shit they say. Oh, well, there the resources are all being used up. No, that's bullshit.
Right.
That's bullshit.
Right. And for those that don't know what Clay is referring to, there is a post that was out, and apparently in Russia they're considering doing a show kind of like in the guise of Mockingjay, what was the name of the actual movie? Mockingjay was one of the
you're talking about Hunger Games.
Hunger Games, excuse me. So you're going to do a premise like Hunger Games where they're actually going to have people sign away their life to be a part of this game where you can actually be killed on this show. You can engage in all types of behavior. You can rape, rob, and pillage all on this show.
That's crazy.
And at the end, you'll have a winner. So this is the Hunger Games in real life that they're trying to do over in Russia. So that's what Clay was referring to. For those that didn't know what he was saying, I just wanted to put that out there because I found the post very interesting and very actually scary even to think about. And again, you're shocked, but then again, you can't be shocked because it seems that every time we reach another technological advancement, we seem to regress in another way. Has anybody caught on to that? We'll move forward technologically, but on the humane side, we seem to be losing something. So
what kills me? People like, that'll never happen. I'm like, people be like, oh, well, this will never happen. I'm like, how you don't know? You know, it kills me. People are like, oh, that never happened. I'm like, let me tell you something. After I saw Trump get in office, I know anything is possible now. So who's to say that 10 years down the road, motherfuckers might not start a fucking purge. Be like, okay, you know what? Y'all can go out and kill motherfuckers for 8 hours to 12 hours and everything be honky-dory, but you got to do it within a 12-hour limit to thin out the fucking population.
Right. Yeah, anything is possible. You know, anything's possible.
Anything's possible now.
At this point,
absolutely correct.
Anything is possible at this particular point. I mean, anything can happen. And like you said, you know, the sad reality behind like these reality shows, everybody is so caught up into controversy. Everybody's so caught up into, you know, chaos and mayhem. So for now, that situation that happened over in Russia to where it seems that they want to be on some real world shit. I mean, or not real world, but actually on some Hunger Games type shit. No. It's very true. You know what I'm saying? People live for a whole bunch of chaos and mayhem.
Right. Right. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Wow. So,
it is.
So as we wind this down here, we got a few moments left. Rob, some thoughts and takeaways, man, tonight from tonight's broadcast. Very interesting. Very moving. Broadcast tonight, man. We had Gary Heyward on, and he talked about his book Corruption Officer, his projects that are coming up, and he spoke about the very tragic and moving Kalief Browder case. Any takeaways and thoughts from that as we wind this down, bro?
Well, one of the biggest things, man, again, shout out to Gary for coming on board and actually just, you know, making things awareness, you know, more or less, just putting awareness out there. The biggest thing, like anything else, is just to keep mind and keep, you know, your eyes open on what's taking place in the world, man, and being able to really, really, you know, take things into consideration and protect your neck, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Clay, any takeaways, man, from tonight's broadcast? Since you want to,
I mean, only thing I said, you know, I'm glad, like the caveat what Rob said, man. I mean, I'm glad dude put the clarity, you know, into what's going on in the prison system. And like Rob said, man, you gotta check your perimeters on the conference because you don't know when you're going to get stopped or you're going to have that confrontation with that cop or whatever. I mean, you just have to be ready and hope for the best, man. Hope that shit comes out. And if shit doesn't go your way, I mean, at least take one of the motherfuckers with you.
Yeah, no, I hear you.
I mean, not
I just,
for nothing, because if I get stopped and I see where it's about to get heated and it looks like I'm going to lose my life, I'm going to take one of the motherfuckers with me.
I feel you. I totally get it. I totally get it, sir. Here's what I do want to say. My takeaway tonight, of course, I watched episode 1 and 2, the Kalief Browder story. And first of all, I just want to say that I think, and I'm sorry, I'm so sad that the man committed suicide after going through all that. Because you know what? The guy was 5'5 and 100 and something pounds, and he was no punk, man. This little kid, man, hung in there. You know, he hung in there. And you know, I mean, he was always outnumbered, so he couldn't do but so much. But the little kid, man, the little guy had some heart, man. He had some heart. And he had a concept of, you know what, I am, you know, in the right here. So, for one, I'm not going to cop to a lesser charge just to go home because I am innocent. All right? And I'm not going to go ahead and be a part of a gang just so I can feel safe and have to be compromised into doing something that I don't want to do. And, you know, to be so young and be able to think that way, I have to give my props to this young man. Again, I'm sorry that he killed himself because he was stronger than he knew he was.
He didn't kill himself. You know what? Drug dealers didn't kill him. Murderers didn't kill him. You know what killed him? The system killed him. The system ultimately killed this man.
Right.
At the end of the day.
Right. Indirectly, they did.
Even though he took his own life, the system killed him.
You're right. They absolutely did. They absolutely did.
No doubt.
You know? But I do want to say this. Another takeaway I get is that, you know what? I'm so thankful and grateful that I did have the parents that I had. Growing up, because I could have easily been a Kalief Browder without that guidance.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, because sometimes I wanted to go out and hang out all hours of the night. He was 16, right, when he went to this party, and then he came back, 16. And these cops picked him up. So at 16, I, you know, Rob, we grew up together. I wanted to do a lot of things. So other kids doing them. My parents were like, I'm not raising other kids. I'm raising you, and you're not going to do certain things. You know, so you know, it seemed weird then because, like, my parents had this thing where I couldn't do back-to-back weekends. So I couldn't go out, you know, and party this weekend and then party the next weekend, too.
That was one of the things.
And I thought it was weird. You know, I said, what do you mean? That was last week. I went, well, you're not going out this weekend. And, you know, I grew up in a strict household for what I consider, you know, being a male child. Me and all my brothers, we grew up in a very strict household. But looking back now, I have to say I'm very thankful that I was raised the way I was raised because I didn't get into a lot of things that I could have gotten into if I didn't have that guidance. You understand?
Yeah.
So I'm thankful and grateful to my parents for that, man. I got to, you know,
man,
because it could have happened to me, man. It could have happened to anybody, you know?
Let me tell you, I'm thankful to my mom, and I'm thankful for dude at Rahway Prison, because had he not told me he would fuck me in my ass,
I would have went out and got into the shit. And then the very start of that motherfucker, drilling me was like, okay, you know what? Nah, I'm staying the fuck out of prison. Never.
Yeah, I hear you.
I hear you.
Whatever, hey, listen, whatever kept you out of that situation. You understand what I'm saying? So,
exactly, bro.
Yeah,
exactly.
So, you know, that's what did it.
But what about for the youth for today? What about the youth today, though? Us, we that generation that we were more, how can I say, geared towards education and bettering ourselves. But what about the generation that don't give a fuck, that's basically, oh, I'm a gangster and I'm going to go out like a gangster? What about that generation?
I don't know. I don't know this generation. I don't know. I don't know. I just don't know. I'll be honest with you. I'm stumped on that one.
Is there no hope for
that? I don't know. I'll be real with you. I do not know. You know, I don't have an answer for that. I wish I did, but I don't. I'll be honest with you. Rob, any thoughts on that?
I tell you, man, it's a different ballgame, because when we was growing up, man, we actually, you know, took pride and we took a lot of respect in what your name was. You know, I'm talking about as far as being a shorty and you had the last name of your parents. You took pride in it.
Yes.
And you
respected
what your parents had told you. You may not have understood it like any job. You have brought up a good point. You know, all right, you can hang out this weekend, but your ass can't hang out next weekend. And you think of that today like, well, damn, what the fuck? You know what I mean? Well, back then you like, what the fuck? But like today you like, oh, shit, you know, I can understand why, you know, my parents did what they did. Or they said they had certain controls in place to where I wouldn't be acting a fool or whatever the case may be. Nowadays, you got the kids out here that are acting like parents, or yet and still, these kids are becoming parents at like 12, 13 years old. So they still kids themselves and don't understand the concept of what, you know, being a parent or being a kid is. You know, so many different aspects that's going on nowadays, bro, that it's just, it's mind-boggling. And then the sad reality of it is, all right, and I hate to use this, but I'm going to use it. You take how hip-hop was back in the days, the culture.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? What it was all about and what rappers were saying. They were actually relaying messages. Now, you see some of the shit that people are doing nowadays, the mumbling and saying shit that I don't understand, but you're paying them a fucking handsome ransom and shit to be fucking idiots. So now everybody's out here wanting to be a fucking idiot and not take, you know, certain things seriously. So you might as well just be like how it was back in the days and shit. Be one of these cats dancing a jig and being basically a fucking court gesture, if you will, for a whole slew of people that don't give a fuck about you. And they'll give you a fraction of you know, the cost of, well, they'll give you a fraction of the money that they're going to make off you by you being a fucking idiot and proving the social, what social media deems as your stereotype. You know what I'm saying? That shit is just ridiculous, man.
Yeah. Hey, I want to bring a caller in here in 2 seconds. I'll give them a brief comment. We wind it down, but I'll bring a caller in. They just press one. But I, you know, the fellas want to be jerks, and all the females want to do is twerk, and that's how I look at it. You know what I'm saying?
We have came from Public Enemy to niggas named Young Thugs who talking about fuck the bitches, where the niggas. I'm like, oh, Jesus. Oh,
yes.
Just, I don't even listen to hip-hop.
Yeah,
no
right.
Yeah. Unless it's old school.
Yeah.
And
that's
it.
Right.
I don't fuck with this shit now. Niggas is mumbling. You know what I'm feeling? And I'm like, what the fuck did I just hear?
Yeah, what are you talking about, man?
What are you talking about?
You have no message. You have no message.
No,
it's nothing behind your shit but garbage.
Yeah, nothing.
That's right.
Garbage. Pure garbage.
Ridiculous.
Public Enemy made sense. NWA made sense. Tupac made sense. Them niggas will probably turn over in their fucking graves right now.
Yeah. It's you know, and I hate to be a conspiracy person, but I think this is done by design too. You know what I'm saying? This is done by design. So, you know. I gotta bring this call in here real quick. Let me bring him in. Hey, 6466, you're live. What's your name? Are you calling for, please?
This is Cassandra from the Dirty South.
Hey,
what's going on, Cassandra? Welcome back to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for tuning in.
Hey,
what are your thoughts from tonight's broadcast, sister?
Well, I didn't get to hear the whole broadcast. I've actually only been here for about the last half an hour. That's why I chimed in.
Okay.
But
okay.
I wanted to say one thing that resonated with what you guys have just been talking about. And it I had to press one because I just had to say that our brothers back that we grew up, you know, the 70 kids, the 70s, we had class. Our parents didn't have class.
Yeah, we did.
To be respectable human beings. And today, their parents are not teaching them to just have simple morals. And I'm not saying all children, but the ones that are out there being the young thugs and all this other stuff and twerking and carrying on.
Right.
Those things, we have fun, but we have different kind of fun. We have pure fun that uplifted one another. And I'm so glad I don't have any little tiny children right now because I would be so afraid of what they're gonna turn if they're gonna turn out to be straight, gay, all these different things. It's so much. This world is just totally different. What happened to playing Skelly outside? What happened to run catch and kiss and all
Ring a Leo, you know, all that.
Right. Red light, green light, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, what happened to that shit?
Hey, but you know what, though? Reality speaking, hip hop is truly dead. It is. Hip hop is dead. To me, it's dead.
Yeah.
It's dead.
Real talk.
It's gone.
And you was naming some of those cats. You forgot Eric B. and Rakim. Don't forget them. Don't forget
that's
Eric
right.
Eric B. and Rakim.
Yeah.
M.O.P. Cool. You remember? That's what I'm saying.
I go back to Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. Man.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. That's right.
Curtis
Cool G Rap. Polo.
Yeah.
Classic. X Clan. You remember X Clan? X Clan was another. That was another one that taught about how everything was going down with the man and us.
That's right.
World talk.
That's right.
Even fighting them.
Tribe Called Quest.
Tribe Called Quest. Yep.
That was rap talking about something, not talking about twerking and I'm going to be your hoe and you're going to be my bitch and all this other stuff.
It's like, come on. Man, it's ridiculous. You know what I'm saying?
I hear them listen to that shit now and I just be disgusted. I'd be like, okay, you know what? I know I'm a dinosaur and I'm good with that because I'm at that age. I'm a dinosaur.
I don't care.
You know, and I'm good with that, but I'm cool.
That's it.
Yeah, we are old people in the club now. Sure.
Yeah, right?
That's okay.
And it's fine. Yeah, I embrace that shit, man. I'm letting my gray hair shine.
That also you don't see anymore, and I know everybody here can witness to this. If I saw Mrs. Hall coming down the street with grocery bags, by the time she hit the block, I was helping her to the building with the grocery bags. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know all the fellas. Oh, hey, go help Miss So and So with her groceries to the building. You know what I'm saying?
I'd be like that on my job. I'd be seeing kids, and I'm like, help your mother.
Yeah, if you were smoking a cigarette and when somebody's parent came down the street, hey, yo, put that down. Here comes so and so, and you put the shit down.
Yeah, real talk.
And you put the shit down. You put it out. You put it down. You know, you walk to a place where she wouldn't see you, and she might know what you're doing, but you just had the respect to not do it directly in front of that elder. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So, and you just don't have that no more. Now, you know, you say and do what you want to in front of your elders. So, I mean, you know, it's bugged out. It's bugged out. But that's all we have tonight, folks. I'm going to go ahead and thank everybody for calling in, those that tuned in, those that were in chat. I want to thank Gary Heyward for joining us tonight. It's always a pleasure to have him on the show with us. We'll be back, guys, next week. Of course, at 7:30, we'll have a topic for you guys here very shortly. We're going to be talking about next week. And don't forget, guys, as always, the number is 657-330-612. And I will have the website back up. It's down right now. The website will be back up, Please go on YouTube and like and subscribe our YouTube page, Real Talk All the Time.
Yes.
Please do that.
Yes.
We appreciate it. And like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. That's all I have, guys. We are about
and
to
in
be
the
out
words
of here.
And in the immortal words of Chuck D, Elvis was a hero to most, but he never meant shit to me. You see that racist was simple. You feel me?
Motherfucker. Hands on
him.
Yeah.
Wow.
Exactly.
Oh,
wow.
Man. Too funny. Yeah.
Goodness
Uh-oh.
Gracious.
Uh-oh. That joint was good.
Yeah. I like that track a lot. That's fun joint. Yeah.
No doubt.
Feeling
speaking of Public Enemy, man, I got to get all the CDs again, man. Every fucking CD,
too.
Man.
No doubt.
That's
I
good,
hope,
man.
So is everybody snowed in or what?
Time,
snowed in?
Not
Word.
Me, man.
Oh, yo, Ja.
I'm good.
Yo, Ja.
Yes, sir.
Habib.
Yes, I'm here.
You know, I put in for my gun permit in Jersey, right?
Uh-oh.
Yes, sir.
Okay. It's about to get real. It's about to
we're
get real.
About
that shit in Jersey. It's gonna take a couple of months.
No,
it's gonna take a couple of months. The cops were like, "What do you need for?" I said, "Oh, target practice." Niggas were like, "Oh, okay." Niggas were looking nervous. Like, "Oh shit." Like, what?
I can't with this.
That's how we do.
Wow.
I gotta surrender mine. I gotta surrender mine.
Oh wow!
Oh,
do you?
She got...
Hey.
Really? That's like 'cause you're moving, right?
Moving, yeah.
Mm. Oh man!
Crazy.
Too bad you gotta do that. That's messed up.
Well, I'm surrendering the permit, but that don't mean I'm surrendering the gun.
Damn!
I ain't doing that. Come on, man.
Oh my goodness. Hey, you know what?
Me.
With that, we out of here. Good night, everybody.
Yeah. One love.
Good night.
Peace.